So good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us tonight on our webinar that's going to be all around understanding gut health. So for those who don't know me, I'm Carla Thomas. I'm a holistic health coach and business coach, and I'm really pleased to have those of you who could make it on live tonight with us. I know it's going to be an incredible session, having already had a bit of a sneak peek at what Nick will be delivering last month. So I want to get straight into it because I really want Nick to be able to cover as much as possible tonight. But I just would love to introduce our guest to you all. So Nick is an accredited practicing dietitian and health coach, and his business or I guess brand is Nutrition Nation. So Nick's whole mission basically behind Nutrition Nation is to promote his message as food being first as medicine. He's also a seasonal lecturer at Curtin and Edith Cowan University and regularly appears at conferences, talks and workshops to talk all things about nutrition. So tonight, obviously, we're going to specifically talk about gut health because I think we can all agree this is not just a hot topic, but the probably hot topic of the moment, which everyone is starting to get into and understand how important it is. And we get a lot of questions around gut health, and anyone would that's within the health and wellness sector. So, Nick, just before I hand it over to you, you know, I just want to share that I've been hearing a lot about this Nick Nation for quite a few months through some of the girls I get to work with, Cami Romini and Dr. Tamara Hunter. And it was only last month that I finally had the pleasure of actually hearing you speak and see what the fuss is about. And I can tell you now that we had, I think, somewhere between 100 and 120 people in the room. Now, this is for our customer VIP night. So if you want to know how you can get an invite to those, please speak to whoever's invited you onto this webinar tonight or shared it with you so they can give you information about how you can get into the juicy events that are privately catered. But at the end of the event, there was basically a rush towards you, Nick, and everyone wanted a piece of you and everyone wanted to ask you a question and book in and grab your cards, which says a lot. And obviously there was a lot of people who couldn't make it live, hence why it was a no-brainer for me to invite you onto a webinar tonight to deliver the info again. So, folks, what I can guarantee you is that as much as you're going to get a bunch of awesome information and education, you're also going to get a bit of a laugh and humor and cheek, which is 100% what we're about here at the Juicy Movement. It's actually one of our values to have a bit of cheek in there. So Nick fits in perfectly. It would definitely not be a boring gut health talk. I can guarantee you that. So with that, Nick, I am going to hand it over to you. Welcome.
Hey, thanks, Carla. Hello, everybody.
They're muted. They can wave. Thank you so much for coming on tonight. And as I said, I'm just really looking forward to delving in with you once again on some of the things that I heard you speak about last month and share with the audience that missed out. So I think let's just start with, why is gut health so important and what does it actually really mean?
Oh, gut health is, well, they're just finding so many things that gut health's associated with, and not just in terms of the actual health of the gut, but more broadly, the health of all your other organs. They're finding links between gut health and cholesterol metabolism, so heart disease prevention. Same with glucose metabolism, so type 2 diabetes prevention. Then there's links with the brain, mental health issues like depression, anxiety, and even things like food cravings and what else? And people's waistlines. So having a healthy gut isn't just about your intestine. It's been proven that there's some pretty cool associations. So, I mean, we're only in our infancy in terms of understanding it, and you've probably heard this before, Carla, but when I was a baby dietitian not too long ago, you know, the large intestine was just a poop tube, really. I didn't say that the other night, but yeah, it was just a tube that removes waste products from the body. You know, fast forward a decade and a bit, and here we are with so much more to learn. Yeah, it's really cool.
So just to sidetrack for a little moment because I love stories. I love storytelling. I love hearing stories. And I love to hear how people actually came into what they're about. So, you know, your fascination with the gut, and you are a dietitian, but this is obviously an area which you really want to focus on and look at first. What's your backstory into getting into dietetics? And also, is there anything in particular that had you focus on the gut, or just because of the clients and what was coming in, it just led you to naturally start really focusing on that?
Yeah, good question. Short-winded story about my background. I used to work at Triple M and Fox FM over in Melbourne and Sydney, driving the cars around and giving away Coke and chips and movie passes and concert tickets, etc. I did a lot of MCing as well. And then I became a tour guide all around Australia. And I think when I was away, just like seeing what people eat, I ate meat pies. I think I said this the other night. I ate meat pies all the way up and down the east coast of Australia for years and years and years, right? And that was before I was a dietitian. But I did see a lot of Aboriginal communities. I learnt a lot about Aboriginal culture, and I saw what Western, not just Western diets, but I saw the effects of a Western diet on a culture that previously wasn't exposed to the foods that we are exposed to today. And I think that kind of sparked my interest back into health, because I originally did a health promotion degree when I first left school. And then I went traveling around the world and, you know, fell in love with traveling. But then I was in a shower in Bolivia and I thought, all right, I think I want to help people with what they're eating, help people get healthier. And
Sharon Bolivia had that.
Yeah, Sharon Bolivia. I must have had some street food or something like that and gone, nah, that's enough. So I was about 15 kilos heavier than I am now. And when I went to baby dietitian school, I kind of learned how to successfully remove that weight and keep it off. The whole gut health thing's kind of just evolved from my clientele. And one of my pet hates at the moment is when someone's walking around with diarrhea or constipation, just living with it and not doing anything about it. And geez, I've helped so many people with those things. And I know there's heaps and heaps more people with unhealthy guts that don't have to put up with it necessarily. There is help out there. I know of a good dietitian anyway.
Yeah. I mean, we'll make sure at the end of this, for anyone that's live, that we'll pop your details into the chat section, and then when the recording's posted up too, the details will be there. But, you know, it's so interesting you say that because, I basically at the age of 25 developed an allergy to wheat. So I'm 31 now. So up until 25, I could eat wheat, no worries. And I had a history, though, of anxiety and depression and have been on meds, etc. And I had started my studies in holistic health and I was sort of on my journey, but I was also in a stage of my life where I was very emotionally exhausted, physically exhausted, you know, a lot of work, a lot of jobs, a lot of study, not a lot of time for me. And that particular year I started to break out randomly in allergy attacks, hives, always brought on by movement or exercise onset though, but I could never figure out what I'd eaten, what I'd done. It was always sporadic until I ended up in the August of that year in hospital with anaphylaxis. And so I was very, very lucky to actually have a doctor in the gym at the time who knew what was going on. Someone had found me, etc. Anyway, we won't go into all of that, but basically what they do is they then send you onto the immunology department because they want to figure out what's caused it. And that's when they figured it was wheat. They don't know what component of it, but just to steer away wheat and gluten and it's exercise onset. So if I get my temperature up and your blood, which is actually it's actually quite a common thing now. So that had me basically, where I'm going with this, is this had me then looking at, well, why now? Why at 25? Why have I got this allergy? So I started looking into the gut and I started looking at documentaries and I started reading about into Natasha Marshall Donnelly and all sorts of things and gaps and all sorts of stuff, and really started to see the connection between the mind and body, but also about how health starts in the gut and understanding about, you know, what gut health is, bacteria and all of that. So this all leads me to really my first primary question of, what is this microbiome we keep hearing about all the time?
Right. So the microbiome is basically all the bugs that live down in your large intestine. So we focus on bacteria a lot of the time, but it also includes things like fungi and maybe even potentially parasites. So that's your microbiome. Actually, the microbiome is actually the role of all of those bugs put together. What role do they perform? And the microbiota are the actual bugs. So we don't really have much, there's not really that much worth in finding out whether, you know, what different types of bacteria you have at the moment, because the different bacteria, we'll say lactobacillus could potentially perform a different role in me compared to what it would perform in you. So knowing exactly what types of bugs we have isn't really that helpful at the moment. What we want to do in the future is work out cheap and affordable ways and more accurate ways of working out what every bug in your gut actually does. And when we can work that out, then all of a sudden, like the industry will just go, it'll boom, and people will be able to, I guess, better take care of themselves depending on what's going on with them.
Really, at the moment, it's like a luck of the draw. So we're trying this varied diet. We're trying to make sure we're getting all kinds of, I guess, probiotic foods into us in the hope that some of those strands are the right ones for what we need, versus down the track, you're going to know exactly and be able to pinpoint it, so you're likely to get like the best results straight away.
Spot on. Yep, exactly.
It amazes me. Like, actually listening to that type of research and what is possible amazes me. And what a difference, and what a lot of time and cost and stress that will save people. Stress obviously playing havoc on the gut as well. So now extending on from this, so what is the difference then between, because we talk about probiotics a lot, but then some people haven't heard about prebiotics or are familiar but don't understand the difference, and also why both are just as important for us?
Yeah, well, it's no surprise that a lot of people know about probiotics. It's a billion-dollar industry, right? So, you know, all you have to do is walk into your local pharmacy and you'll find things like Inner Health Plus, you know, your Cults in your supermarkets. In fact, your Cult's been there for ages. Bit of a pioneer in terms of the probiotic world. So that's your supplement. And essentially what you're doing there is you're either taking a powder or a capsule or something like that. And that's full of bugs. So I'm dumbing down bugs, full of microbes, right? The idea is that if you're pumping in billions of those microbes, you're going to at least have, you know, 1 or 2 billion, maybe million of those bugs that actually make it down into your large intestine. But unfortunately, no matter what they come in, whether they come with sugar like Yakult, so that's supposed to try and protect the microorganism from being broken down and killed by your stomach acid. But come on, like, really? Sugar? Anyway, and then you've got your capsules, which are designed to do the same thing. Anyway, what we find is that they don't actually make it all the way down into the large intestine, which is, you know, what they're designed to do. They're designed to fill a hole. There's missing microbes down there that could potentially have beneficial effect, and we're trying to get more down there to kind of fill that gap, but they're not making it. However, in saying that, there's a stack of really interesting positive research around probiotics, and particularly people that have like irritable bowel syndrome or diverticulitis, ulcerative colitis, all these lower intestine conditions, but even like mental health disorders like you know, depression and anxiety. So even though the probiotic's not actually getting down to where we're trying to get it to, but still having not only beneficial effects to our guts, but also even our brain. So the theory is dead protein creates, from the microbe, creates a anti-inflammatory effect, which goes all around the body.
It really is a ripple effect, isn't it? I mean, and that's the thing with health. You know, anything that you do is likely to have, you know, even if you start something for one area of your health in particular, it's probably going to be affecting and benefiting another two, three, four, you know, five areas of your health in some way. So fascinating. Like when I first heard you talk about the dead protein part, I was like, whoa, so much to learn.
That's pretty interesting though that you say that, because like look at your cool, going back to the sugar, like that's just going to, if it prevents those microbes from dying at least a little bit more, but what's happening to the other side of things? So it's not just about the gut. If you're taking in unnecessary sugar, you're going to get an insulin spike, your body will go into like storage mode. You may put on weight because you're trying to take this Yakult to make yourself healthier. So, you know. Yeah.
Power of marketing. And, sort of goes back to all the fruit and veg campaigns and yada, yada. But anyway, we'll try and stay on topic. I've got the notes. So that brings us back to then. When we're talking about foods and that affect both our gut and our bodies in a positive and a negative way, well, what foods should we be eating then to promote optimal gut health?
So with prebiotics, I talked about probiotics just then, but prebiotics are the things that actually have convincing evidence around them, like proper human trials, showing favorable results all around the body, not just in the gut. And what a prebiotic is it's a food or a plant essentially that's escaped digestion from the small intestine. It's gone all the way down to, and you with me? It's gone all the way down into the large intestine, and it's been fermented by your microbes, so fermented or digested. So that's a prebiotic. And so what that's really doing is it's feeding the bugs, some of your bugs, down in your lower gut. And that's essentially it. So the bugs are like us, we need to eat, so do they. But when they eat, they produce all these really favorable metabolites, which then translocate over into the bloodstream and kind of share the love everywhere. So in terms of foods, so you'd be looking at things like soluble fibers and resistant starches. So some examples of soluble fiber, oats, barley, fruit and veg, flesh, legumes, nuts and seeds, things like that. And then in terms of resistant starch, you'd be looking at, there's this new phenomenon about how you need to cook your, if you cook your pastas, what happened there? Hang on a second. That's better.
Hi, Daddy.
Hi. Hang on. You want to say hi? Hi. Good night.
Your gut is fantastic.
Good night, Daddy. Come on.
Sorry about that, everybody. So where was I? Oh, yeah. Resistant starch.
Yeah, resistant starch. That's right.
So if you cook pasta or cook rice and then you let it cool and then you cook it again, or even if you just eat it cooled, it becomes a resistant starch, something that would normally be very digestible in the small intestine. It would raise your blood sugar levels really high. But when you cook it and cool it, all of a sudden it becomes something that's really, really hard to digest. And best of all, your gut microbes, when it actually makes its way down to the large intestine, they have a massive party. They love the stuff.
Wow.
However, without insoluble fiber, you're not actually spreading that love the whole way down the large intestine. And that's a really key point out of what I want to convey today. And in fact, I'll probably mention it again at the end just to summarize, because if you're just feeding all the gut microbes that love plants at the top of the large intestine and not spreading that love all the way down the large intestine, you're just not getting as many of those favorable metabolites that translocate into the bloodstream and convey those health benefits. But not only that, when you don't have plant munching microbes eating well and happy and healthy, what you get is other microbes that start to proliferate. And those other microbes could potentially cause systemic inflammation. And inflammation essentially just exacerbates pretty much any condition known to man and woman. So it's really important to make sure that all of your plant munching microbes the whole way down the large intestine are happy. And insoluble fiber makes that happen. So food sources like, like whole grains, like basmati rices, brown rices, nuts and seeds, once again. So you get a bit of insoluble fiber in nuts and seeds as well as soluble fiber. So it's kind of like with nuts and seeds, you're killing two birds with one stone. And then you can get things like supplements, like a green banana powder that you can find in Woolies. And it's pretty funny how even Woolies are on the gut health bandwagon. Like, seriously, how good's that? Normally green banana powder would only be something you could find in a hippie, health food store down my way in Fremantle, right? There's also things like raw artichoke, Jerusalem artichoke, which no one would go anywhere near with a 10-foot pole because it's just like disgusting unless it's cooked. But the raw, some food companies have actually ground down raw Jerusalem artichoke into powder, and that can be a nice little, form of fiber that even for someone who doesn't typically get a variety of different fiber types, that can be a way of kind of hacking that whole system. Mm. Does that kind of, all that kind of make sense?
Yeah. I mean, just to summarize, like what I loved and what you shared with some of those food examples was, there's plenty of options if you have a dietary issue. You'll always be able to find something that's going to be fine for you to have. So really, dietary issues can be make things more challenging, but not impossible, which I think is a good point. And also too, it explains when you were talking about how if you don't sort of get that variety and especially getting the insoluble fiber to carry everything all the way through the intestine, it explains why a lot of people have that, but I'm doing the right thing. Why am I not noticing difference? Well, it might just be that they're not adding one component that's allowing it to, like you said, travel all the way down or just got things out of balance, because it is such a fine line. I'm sure being a dietitian, you'll see it all the time. It's not that people are necessarily doing it wrong. They just haven't got the magic recipe for their body quite there yet in what they are putting into it, which I suppose then is why supplements as such, or those powders and everything they're getting onto now that we might not be able to eat really, like, Jerusalem artichoke, how often are we eating that at home, for example? But if you can add that into your food in other ways, or your breakfast or smoothies, and fantastic. And same with that green banana powder. I'm yet to see if, by the way, if you're at our event last month, there was a lady who said she liked green bananas and didn't mind them, and we did challenge her. So I'd love to see if she ended up eating green bananas. Powder, by the way, if you are on my health, shout out. But so that's why it's obviously important that, we do eat a large variety of fruits and vegetables. And as you mentioned, a lot of the goodness is really in the skin as well. If we're getting good quality and we're washing it right, we know it's grown right, then we don't have to worry so much about the, the chemicals and the pesticides, etc., which is really the big thing nowadays why we tend to peel everything. Not that we, never used to need to. So where would you say then supplements play a role? And I will get you to make a tiny mention of the ones that you have used or promote or would recommend. And for those tonight on here that do take Juice Plus, why that would be something that you would think is a great option if you are supplementing.
Yeah, well, depends on if there's a deficiency or not. in private practice, I come across the whole host of different nutrient deficiencies, from zinc to vitamin A, vitamin E, vitamin B12, B6, iron is like, it's something that every GP in a blood test will test. What else? There's this whole stack of them, basically the whole, you know, even selenium and iodine and things like that. And most people, when I send them for a blood test, they'll come back with a deficiency of some kind. I mean, even I've had deficiencies and I'm a dietitian. Yeah. I've had a B12 deficiency and I was tired, lethargic, couldn't concentrate. And I was only at the beginning of that deficiency. If I hadn't have picked up on it with a blood test, I would have been in strife. One thing that, I mean, I'm taking the, I don't even know what they're called. I'm taking the vegetable and the fruit GIS Plus at the moment, the capsules. And the reasoning behind that for me was I'm always looking to try new things and see what people are talking about, whether they have an effect on me or not. I really hate needles, so I didn't go and get a baseline blood test and then do a follow-up blood test. But I know that throughout winter, you know, when you've seen my little baby, my little two-year-old Sunny now, you know, she's bringing home disease after sickness after disease back from daycare. And I only get, when I get sick, I really get sick, but I never get run down and caught like just mild colds. Like I get proper man flu or nothing. Whereas
I love how you said the proper man flu, not the man flu, the real man flu. Yeah,
totally. Whereas the little niggles, they just seem to have gone away. And what attracted me to that product in particular was the fact that, you know, it's really based on real food. So it's not like this chemical, or I should say synthetic supplement that you would get in the chemist or the pharmacy for like, you know, iron or zinc or whatever it may be. You're actually getting, you know, the real nutrients from the real food. And the reason when I delved into the research, it was all about, you know, reducing inflammation. And as I said before, inflammation is pretty much connected to most of the diseases that that humans experience. I mean, like worst case scenario, cancer, you know, when you were talking about your allergies or intolerances, you know, inflammation can actually exacerbate those conditions, those situations. And the list goes on. Like if with inflammation, if you're eating lots of saturated fat, you get high cholesterol, and then that cholesterol is more likely to stick to your blood vessels if you're in an inflamed state. So kind of babbling on here about inflammation, but I guess that's really what attracted me to the product itself. And you know, I've maintained it, and yeah, I just think it's a really good thing. And another thing about Juice Plus is I think it really encourages people to make better food choices as well. And that, anything that, in my profession, anything that makes people make better food choices is amazing, right? So long as it doesn't harm them. And I can't see how Juice Plus would harm anybody. It's win-win.
Yeah. And coming from, like you said, with your background, everything is very much science-based. So I suppose for you too, that's another big tick, and to make sure that when you are recommending or taking anything for yourself, you know that you can back it up with information that, you know, it's going to be doing something positive in your bloodstream and your clients or anyone else's as well. So I think that's wonderful. So thank you for extending on that. And then also too, I have noted down about the green banana powder again. Yeah, I have to source that. And the Jerusalem artichoke powder. That's a very interesting one. So, right, now moving on. So what would you say are the biggest misconceptions around gut health?
Yeah, that's that probiotics will save the day. You know, one magic pill will automatically fix your gut. another misconception might be that, you know, a probiotic food like a kombucha is going to make you automatically healthy. And also that gut health is, you know, the be all and end all of total body health as well. So it's really, I like to treat the gut as a, as an organ, just like your heart and your pancreas and your brain, etc. So looking after the gut obviously links to everything else, but so does everything else. So it's really just one particular area that we're getting really excited about, and there's some awesome stuff coming out about what it's associated with. But, you know, all the other organs are doing amazing things as well. So making sure that we're looking after them too. And also the fiber thing, you know, like traditionally we were under the impression that you just had to have 25 grams to 35 grams of fiber a day. Now we're finding that you need soluble resistant starch, the fermentable types of fibers, complemented with insoluble fiber as well. So that's like blowing people's minds. Like when I'm out talking in the general public, that's like completely new to them. And we're only really finding out about this stuff because of all the amazing research being conducted on gut health. So yeah, I think that's a misconception that you just, you know, you can eat plates and plates of broccoli and be doing really good stuff for your gut. That's just not the case. You need balance.
Yeah. And I love that you said that word, because again, it goes down to the whole, no, you can't just have one form of, you know, like drink or one form of food or meal that you're using all the time. And no, you can't just do that once a week and think that's going to fix everything. It's getting a bit of all the stuff you need and consistently. Ultimately, that's when you get good gut health. And you don't have any of these issues that everyone talks about having when you are actually, as you said, hitting all those key points, but doing it every day. And realistically, if we were eating a whole food-based diet, it wouldn't be an issue to get it in every day because we're crowding out any of the other stuff that we don't need and isn't great for us. And I think that's really the key. And it takes time to get there. But as you said, it's so worthwhile when it ends up ticking off this issue and that issue, be that a physical issue, or as you pointed out before, the research is showing what a difference it's making in people's mindsets. And I can attest to that 100% because back when I was going through that, the gut was never looked at. It wasn't even connected or shown in any way. And I did through all my research, seeing how that was affecting that and that was affecting that. And when everything over time got taken care of, or here I am today, you know. So, yeah, I love that you said that. There was a question that came through, and you spoke a little bit about this last month, which I thought was really important. But I had someone write in asking about when babies or newborns are basically put on antibiotics, you know, straight away, how this affects their gut, and also how can a new mama work to repair or establish the gut flora that's been basically compromised?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And we're finding out that, you know, the first 3 years of life, I keep hearing it everywhere. It's, you know, people are, it's becoming, even the media are starting to get hold of it. Essentially, the first 3 years of life are really important to lay down a whole bunch of microbiodiversity. And obviously, you know, C-sections versus natural births, and breastfeeding versus formula feeding, and the types of first foods that are introduced. Are they crappy, high sugar, really high processed, but iron fortified special first foods, which food companies are doing great out of, or are they simply just mummy and daddy's really healthy meal kind of blitzed up, or is it baby-led weaning where the baby's just kind of, you know, grabbing at things and trying them and, you know, going about it that way? And then, like, how much exposure do these young infants, babies, you know, as they're growing older, how much exposure do they have to dirt and all the bugs that we find outside? And, you know, is the fact that one in seven people in Australia are experiencing irritable bowel syndrome, is that because we're so clean now? Like everything's like sanitized, and you know, the even outside, everything's so much cleaner probably than what it used to be. I heard of an inappropriate comment. I probably won't mention it too much, but you know, it's almost like the more bacteria that you can expose your child to earlier on, the better. And this gastroenterologist was online talking to other gastroenterologists. I just heard this through a gastroenterologist. I can't even say that three times straight.
The GI grapevine.
Yeah, pretty much. That, you know, C-section, women that go for a C-sec should actually tell the doctor not to clean his hands, and when he's dealing with the baby, just have really dirty hands and expose those babies to more bugs. Who knows? He said it in a much more disgusting way, which I won't say online tonight. But yeah, so the more exposure to different kinds of bugs, the better. In terms of antibiotics, both my children were on antibiotics in the first, you know, hour of life. And, you know, they're 2 and 4, and I knew all this stuff back then. And so that was really hard for me to stomach. See how we use stomach? That was hard for me to stomach. We use gut as such an emotional tool. Mm-hmm. So all the great work that my wife did by giving birth to 2 children and doing it naturally because she was able to, you know, like C-sections, they're lifesavers, right? So I'm by no means knocking that. But all the bacteria that was transferred through that birthing process from mother to child was completely obliterated by the antibiotics. So those poor children were like pushed back a little bit. Mm. However, the antibiotics normally only deplete the bacteria. They don't normally kill it right off. Now, when I say normally, I mean like if you're having antibiotic dose after dose after dose after dose, yeah, you're probably going to kill off your diversity. But so long as there are, you know, representatives from each different kind of microbe group, then all you really need to do is start feeding them the foods that they like, and then they grow back again. So that's the good news about all that stuff. So I hope in a very long-winded way I answered that question.
Yeah, I think what that is just is answering that, like, there is hope. It's not like it's all doom and gloom. And I love how you pointed out, if you've got the diversity, it's pretty much just multiplying the right foods. And that's where an expert like yourself is worth seeing or going to, or, you know, a podiatrist, whoever, not a podiatrist, a pediatric, a podiatrist, I don't think that'll help, to be able to find out exactly what they should do from there to be able to help, as you said, with the bulb, and get an expert to... Yeah. Be able to build up on that. So we've pretty much hit time. So I would just love, before we finish off, to ask you to maybe give 3 to 5 simple action steps. If that was it, if you had to leave and give people something to walk away here from tonight, 3 to 5 steps that would be optimal in promoting our gut health.
So if you're suffering from any kind of irritable bowel syndrome, whether it be constipation or diarrhea, please don't continue living with it and putting up with it. If you're in IBS limbo, so you've gone to the doctor, you've got an endoscopy, or your stool's been sent off for, you know, to be checked, and then the GP's like, you know, nothing's wrong, everything's coming back negative, nothing's wrong with you. And then you're like, but I've still got the symptoms. Don't just take that. Like, what people will tend to do in that situation is they'll get onto Dr. Google, cut out gluten, cut out dairy, cut out this food, cut out that food, and you're left with a really restrictive diet, and you're probably going to be one of those people that come and see someone like me with a whole bunch of nutrient deficiencies. So just accept it, go and see someone who knows gut health, and try and navigate that space so that you still get all the nutrition you need. My next point would be balance. So, you know, we talk about the healthier gut microbes, but when we're talking about the microbiome, we really need a balance of all different microbes. So we need the plant munchers to release a lot of those really favorable metabolites that I was talking about that go around the body. But if there's too many plant munchers, that can be unhealthy. You get a growth of the mucosal lining, and it can actually really narrow the lower gut so that, you know, the feces can't go through nice and smoothly, and it could end up being a diarrhea or constipation situation. So balance is great. So not only all those foods I talked about, those fibers, the soluble, insoluble, and resistant starch, but also healthy fats, you know, good sources of protein. And that their byproducts actually help, and this is just one example, they help to keep that mucosal lining at bay. So long as you've got the plant munching microbes as well, you've got the optimum situation down there, right? So it's really not about good and bad, it's about balance. So balance is really, really important. And then it really comes down to those three different fiber types. So if I was, I like to use the analogy of if I'm at a party or a function and I'm standing right by the kitchen, obviously when the waiter or waitress comes out with food, I'm happy as Larry, right? I'm eating, I'm happy. But what about those poor buggers all the way down the other end away from the kitchen? The waiter waitress isn't even getting anywhere near them because all the food's already been taken. And if I was to transfer this analogy to the gut, what I'm saying here is, you know, you've got all those fermentable fibers from soluble and resistant starch, but all the gut microbes up the top of the large intestine are feasting and partying, whereas those poor buggers down the bottom, right by the business end, they're actually not getting to feed on those, well, the plant munching ones aren't getting to feed on those awesome sources of fiber. Because there's no insoluble fiber there, right? So making sure you're getting insoluble, soluble, and resistant starch, and one from each category on a daily basis.
Awesome. I love that.
Probably...
It's such simple information. You often sometimes wonder where we're getting it so wrong when it is actually quite simple. It's just, like you said, doing the do, and I think that's the hard thing in this day and age, and it can get very confusing, and there's all sorts of food and all different things that we're getting told to do, etc. But yeah, I think what you've just given us to be able to walk away from tonight is very achievable in small steps, bit at a time. So Nick, I'm going to wrap it up there because we're 45 minutes of your time, but I have absolutely loved chatting with you tonight. I don't know about anyone else, it doesn't really matter. I've had a grand old time on here anyway, and I've definitely got all the information I need, so that's okay. But I'm super, super grateful for you to have given your time and for free. And this is definitely a webinar which I will be happily sharing around with as many people as I can, because I'm still learning so much constantly with everything coming out about gut health myself, and always keen to apply and try things too that then I can recommend onto clients. So, Nick, where can anyone on here tonight or that listens to the recording find you?
Oh, yeah. When I'm not lurking around the streets late at night,
He's out of bounds.
I work out of Ellen Health in Fremantle, and it's on the corner of Ray Avenue and Hampton Road. I also work in Claremont out of ProMotion Physiotherapy.
Great.
So that's where I conduct my private practice. I also do some online coaching, so that'd be getting in contact with me and setting you up so I can coach you on a daily basis. Some people, believe it or not, really find that valuable. Some people, they're like, that's like my worst nightmare, having a dietitian looking over everything I'm eating every single meal of the day. So depends on, like, everyone's different. And then I do lots of talks around town, similar to what I did the other night at the Floriette Bowling Club.
Yeah.
So, and lots of these types of things too. I'm thinking Are we able to share a slide? Not now, but as a, I don't know, up on your Facebook or.
Yeah, we can we can attach that with the recording, or we can send it out to anyone that's on the database, which is how they would have also gotten a reminder about tonight as well. So if you want to email that to me and let me know, that's fine. I'm more than happy to share that. Now, on just on your social medias, quick. So it's Nutrition Nation, both on Instagram and on Facebook.
It's Nick Nutrition Nation.
Website?
www.nutritionnation.com.au.
Awesome. So I will make sure, again, if anyone needs that, to just reach out, again, if you've forgotten that all or written it down or whatever, and we'll make sure you can get in contact with Nick if you want, or just be able to follow him and see what he's up to. But other than that, I'm going to leave it there, and I'm just going to stop recording.